So I'm also very grateful that Leader Pelosi is here. And of course, veterans is not a new issue for her. She was the first leader that would meet literally quarterly with all the veterans, all the veteran organizations in D.C. No one else did that prior to her. And she actually invited me to some of those meetings, and I was very proud to be there. But she's also obviously a friend of the Bay Area. It's been, she has come to our homeless, every time we do a housing program, Nancy's always there. She stays way too long. She talks to all the veterans in the program. Her staff like tries to drag her out of these sessions. But she really cares, and she has like done everything in her power, really, to get veterans, make sure veterans' needs are taken care of. So we're very, really fortunate to have a friend like Nancy Pelosi. So with that, I'd like to introduce.
Speech and Edgar Escobar, thank you for your leadership. I also want to acknowledge my daughter Christine Pelosi, who is here as a member of the, she's a member of the Democratic National Committee, and as such, she was a leader in insisting that they have a veterans desk at the Democratic National Committee. That he wrote the dissenting view on the Commission on Care Review. I was so very moved. I was so very, very proud of him. I've seen his work for decades. As Paul has mentioned, he's been working with Swords to Plowshares for a long time, so I've been aware of his leadership for a long time on behalf of our vets. So I was honored recently to appoint him to that Commission on Care, but even earlier than that, to invite him to our regular meeting with the Veteran Service Organizations in Washington, D.C., going back to when I first became leader almost a dozen years ago, and then speaker and then leader again. But Michael, when he would come, I'd say to them, I want to introduce you to a saint. He would blush as he's blushing now, but not for long. He would soon speak up on behalf of veterans there. We had our most recent meeting just about a week or so ago before we broke for Easter Passover. And what I want to say is it was, as usual, very informative, very strong meeting. But at this time, it very much focused, and that is a decision of the vets. They decided that they were going to focus on... Okay, thank you. That they would that meeting... I could use my mother five voice for the whole room. You let me know when it's right. I'll just keep talking. I won't go back, though. At this meeting, we focused on women veterans and the rising list of concerns that we have for women veterans. That's a very large and growing number as well. But we always take our agenda from what the veterans bring in. Going back to our first meetings, we talked about concurrent receipt, which we relabeled the debt, veterans disability tax, and fought it in Congress. Issues that relate to survivor benefits, you name it, just the full array. But saying to the group, you prioritize, we will act upon it. And when we got the majority, we were able to allocate the resources necessary to implement some of the policy that we were able to achieve earlier. I was very proud, Paul, that at the American Legion Convention when I was nominated, I'll put up a self-serving sign, when I was introduced at that, the commander said that I had done more as speaker, was recognized more as speaker than any other speaker in terms of meeting the needs of our veterans since the GI Bill. So we were very, very excited about the recognition of your work. Your priority. So I came here today to listen. That's, I think, the most valuable thing. I learn more when I listen than when I speak. And I've come here to listen to your concerns. But I want to put them in this context. A couple days ago, we had a social media call where we meet with all of the groups, Vote Vets, Daily Coast, Move On, and all different groups, Planned Parenthood, all these groups, about how we could protect the Affordable Care Act. Well, then in the meantime, Syria intervened, so our veterans were even a stronger voice. Well, they're always strong, but even had more questions for them in this call. And at the end of the call, I said, you know, when we're talking about vets, and we're talking about the VA, that's really important for us. But our veterans' needs go well beyond VA. It's about housing and how the HUD is funded. It's about mental health. It's about the Affordable Care Act and other issues, about Medicaid. It's about opioids, which is part of the Medicaid solution that we have in our legislation. And they said, and so there are so many other things that affect our well-being than as important as the VA is. But one of the most important things that affect us is we like to have peace so that we can get well, so that we can repair, so that we don't have to. Because as we know, and you've heard it over and over, you said it yourself, on the battlefield, and we're on the battlefield, we leave no soldier behind. And when they come home, we leave no veteran behind. That is our mantra, and you have to help us make that happen. Because as Michael said, this commission, if they're not listening to vets, they're just talking to each other. And this threat that loomed large during the presidential campaign of privatizing the VA is a real threat. We will not let them make money off of delivering health care to our veterans, and that's what privatization is. To a more make profit off of our vets' place. So this is in our meeting, except for when sometimes one group that represents nobody, but has money from somebody, Concerned Veterans of America, I hope none of you are here, but if you are, I want you to hear what I have to say, that they come to our meeting every now and then. I've never heard them speak up. I don't know if I've recognized them, but anyway, I don't shut anybody out. But all of the VA, of the Veterans Service Organizations, are unified that we will not privatize. Now, having said that, do we want to address concerns that we have to make the delivery of service better? Do we want to recognize how that fits very much in our healthcare system and how we need other things? I have on this pin this morning, we started, planted a garden to start the construction of the barrier and the net at the Golden Gate Bridge. We spent a lot of time with families who had lost their loved ones, taking their own lives. We know that that is an increasing problem across the board in our country, including among our veterans. So our mental health issues are very, very important, and in fact, we're very dismayed that our colleagues across the aisle did not make addressing mental health issues. They took off that list out of things that must be done. So let's look up here. Veterans Healthcare Action Campaign. Veterans. It's about our veterans' healthcare and taking action and having a campaign. Understand this very clearly. Nothing is more eloquent to a member of Congress than the voice his or her own constituents. You're my bosses, or if you're not my district, you're somebody else's bosses. So let your voice be known to them as well. Your experience is the wisdom that we need to make the decisions when we have choices to make. Of all the things that President Trump has done, one thing I am happy about is his choice of the Secretary of Veterans Affairs. The secretary there, so far, so good. Wouldn't you say?
Yes.
So far, so good. Because we thought for sure he was going to put a privatizer at the head of the VA, and that would have been very problematic. We'll see how we go from there. A couple other thoughts just to say today, this spring is the 100th anniversary since our entry into World War I, 75 years since the Bataan Death March, 14 years since the invasion of Iraq. So sad. So sad, so many veterans coming home. So we are getting hundreds of thousands of service members each year becoming veterans, challenging our system. Over 70% of our nation's 21 million veterans are over the age of 45, including a majority of veterans in San Francisco. As I mentioned, many more women, and we need to address those concerns, and that's why we have our regular Veteran Service Organizations meetings, and that's why I am here to hear what you have to say on the ongoing, but as a group here today. There are, again, we are very, very concerned about this issue of privatization. Privatization would virtually end the guarantee of free health care for those who have served. Privatization would see the VA stores closed for most of its 366,000 employees, a third of whom are veterans themselves. And 100,000 of the workers in the VA are vets. While ensuring the VA can better coordinate care in the community where there are gaps, we have to be smart, we have to be cautious. Nearly 130% of care is already provided outside the VA, you know that. Increasing that amount of care outside the VA could have a negative impact on comprehensive and specialty care. There are just some things the VA knows better. Combat-related injuries and the rest, there are just some things they can diagnose more readily, care for with experience of having cared for others. At the VA, veterans are treated as a whole person, as the only service-connected, comprehensive care culture that provides unparalleled personal medical expertise. We must lift, not level, the VA. VA privatization is not the answer. I look forward to our forum and debunking the myth of what veterans' choice really means, what that really means. We must hold our bedrock promise, again, just as the military leaves no one behind on the battlefield, we must leave no veteran behind when they come home. That is our promise. Not only that, it is our value system. It is an ethical commitment that we have to you, who make us the home of the brave and the land of the free. And when we're doing that, we have to also consider what they're doing in the budget. The budget is should be a statement of our national values as to what is important to us as a nation, should be reflected in that budget. And veterans come to me all the time and say, we need the biomedical research. We need these other things that they are cutting because this is something that we all benefit from. So as a statement of our value, our veterans are not at that place, the place that we want them to be. So it's pretty exciting to see right now, learn our lesson from the March on Washington, which many of you participated in, all over the world and every continent. What was good about it was it was spontaneous. It wasn't organized by politicians or elected officials. It was spontaneous, and different groups joined in. And what was good about it, too, is that when it came time for the airport and bands and this and that, people showed up. The steps of the Supreme Court, people showed up. And when the Affordable Care Act was under threat by with a bill that was, they called an act of mercy, but it was really an act of malice in what it did to working families in our country. The biggest transfer of wealth, the Republican bill was the biggest, if I'm used a partisan word, forgive me here, but the biggest transfer of wealth in the history of our country. Robin Hood in reverse, $600 billion lifted from middle-income families and those who aspire to the middle class to the wealthiest people in our country. So as we gather here to talk about this, it comes down to budget. It comes down to budget, how we're going to allocate the resources, and that's why they want to move to privatize and say, we're going to save money. No, we're here to save lives and to improve the quality of of care and lives, to honor the vision of our founders, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. We want people to have a healthier life and the liberty to pursue their happiness. And when we do whatever we do, it has to be to honor the vows of our founders, the sacrifice of our men and women in uniform. You're right there on par with our founders, and of course the aspirations of our children. So thank you for all that you have done for our country, for your leadership, for your service, and for your concern, not only about you, but for so many other veterans as they come back home. Thank you all very much for the honor of having a time to share some thoughts with you. I look forward to hearing what you all have to say. Thank you all very much. God bless you. God bless you.